called him and I told him there's something strange growing in the canal.
All right, this is what we have all out in the river here now, and it's spreading like wildfire, and we need to get rid of it.
You can keep it under control with treatment. Without treatment, it's going to grow and eventually choke off the river.
When thinking about aquatic invasive plant species, hydrilla is actually one of the worst of the worst. Has a number of survival mechanisms which help it to rapidly spread and make it extremely difficult to manage. Not only can it outcompete a lot of our native seagrasses, but it can grow as deep as 20 feet, especially in clear water. Now, if you're asking yourself, how do I identify hydrilla? You can take a look at the plant. You'll notice that the leaves are in whorls around the stem. Most of the time, those leaves are in arrangements of 4 to 8. Hydrilla also has serrations or a spiny feeling around those leaves, which differentiate it from other species.
A lot of folks that aren't impacted directly by hydrilla really don't even know what it is or have never even heard of it. In Edenton in particular, they're becoming more and more familiar with the plant, unfortunately, because it is taking over the Chowan River and portions of that water body that are near where people frequent. In other places, it's just establishing. People aren't as aware of it. But in reality, all of this water is flowing out and into our coastal regions, which means these plants can do the same. And when we think about a plant like hydrilla in some of our coastal systems and what those coastal systems mean for the state of North Carolina, there could be some major, major problems and impacts.
Like many of our aquatic invasive plant species, hydrilla actually originated from overseas as part of the aquarium trade. And as it's established itself in a number of water bodies throughout the nation, it spreads on the back of boat trailers and via wildlife. So North Carolina really saw its first establishment of hydrilla in 1980 in Umstead State Park. And from that point on, we began to see it in reservoirs across the state, spreading mainly out from that Wake County infestation at Umstead to other portions and parts of the state. What about the North Carolina coast? A lot of our back swamp areas that come into our estuaries that look like this currently will look like this in the future if it continues to spread without any control, without essentially being stopped. It grows in a wide range of conditions. Most importantly is salinity, the Chowan running right into the Albemarle Sound. A lot of folks think that because of saltwater, hydrilla won't be able to expand in the Albemarle and Pamlico in our estuaries. Well, we've done field trials here at NC State, had survival out to 18 parts per thousand salinity. So 18 is our estuary, and this plant can survive in those conditions. When you introduce an invasive species, in a lot of cases, what happens is this species forms a monoculture. It basically outcompetes all of those other species, displaces them, and becomes the only plant in that system.
There's all kinds of species that grow in the waterways. It's just like grass in the yard. You have weeds and grasses in the river, and it's good. It's good for wildlife habitat and fish habitat. But invasives will, when it comes to that, it overtakes and overshadows the good, and then you have a problem.
So when we think about the impacts of hydrilla, most often we're thinking about the fact that it keeps us from swimming or boating, but in reality, the impacts are pretty far-reaching. You're talking about economic value, whether that be for tourism. You're also talking about a fisheries side of things. When you look at the coastal portions of North Carolina, they're very driven by the fisheries aspect, and hydrilla can negatively impact that.
Vegetation, in particular hydrilla, since it forms such a dense mat, causes the fishermen, particularly flying the fishermen, who are fishing gill nets in inshore waters, and they use the fish in 3 to 6 foot contour. And if that contour is full of hydrilla, then he spends an awful lot of time just clearing grass out of his gear. It increases his fishing time probably 5 times over. So it takes him longer to do what he normally could do. It takes him 5 hours to do what he could do in an hour. And it cuts his catch down.
It's going to be an economic impact on our area. And we're not going to attract retirees who want to look at hydrilla. They want to look at nice, clean waterfront. They want to look at good fishing. Well, they're just not going to move here. They'll move somewhere else.
Last year, we became aware of just how significant the problem is in the region. So much of what we have, so many of our assets that we have are connected to our water, to the bay, to the sound, to the rivers, to the creeks. And the issue of hydrilla is something that we take very, very seriously. We met Rob Emmons with the State Aquatic Weed Control Program, and then we also worked with our local extension agents, and they helped educate us on the problem. The council has funded money every year for the last 3 years in the budget, a local match that's required to match state funds. Last time I checked in with Rob, we learned that our efforts are starting to make a difference. The thought is that we will have to continue to treat the hydrilla in the areas that it's been identified, probably for another couple of years.
This is a long-term project because, like I say, it grows from the bottom up. It works from tubers underneath the ground. You can kill it, but it'll come right back. Have to hit it several times or several years in a row before you can start getting a control. We're trying to get up with Bertie County on the Chowan River side because if we treat our side and they don't do their side, if a segment of that hydrilla breaks off and flows to our side and takes root again, we here we go again.
So today we came here to actually apply herbicide. This is the third year of herbicide applications and hydrilla management here. And herbicide is just economically, the best approach for us to manage hydrilla here. We have several herbicides that we use. They're all special herbicides. They're special in the sense they're approved for aquatic use. We use grass carp in some of our reservoirs, but grass carp is not going to be an option to use in these sites because they're open to the Chowan River and there's no way to keep the carp in these canals.
Hydrilla is a very fast-moving and aggressive plant, so when we're thinking about management or making an impact, we really need to act as quickly as possible. Oftentimes, management takes the involvement of local, state, and even federal government in some cases, as well as the citizens in an area. Along with state and local collaboration, NC State University and NC Sea Grant have teamed up together to provide support on this issue. Citizens can get involved by helping us map and monitor hydrilla in the area. If you would like to get involved with mapping hydrilla, keep your eye out for local projects or even develop your own. With a little help from NC State University, we can help you identify these weeds in your area. It'll take that collaborative effort from all of us to really make a difference to manage hydrilla in this area.